Greetings, welcome back to Randomtronic. My name is Chris, and today I've got this little board that I've pulled out of the camera, and I thought it's about time I will try to make a standalone flash circuit. Most of the components are on the board, so it should be relatively simple. We should be able to just take those off, build our own simple circuit, and yeah, get it to flash. Supercharged blinky, I guess? Just for fun, why not? Here is a very simplified schematic of how a flash circuit works. This is the Xenon flash tube here. It's got two terminals and the polarity doesn't matter, it's irrelevant. And there is also a third connection usually. And in this case, as I've shown before, it's this one here. And this goes to the metal reflector on around the Xenon flash tube. And this will be the trigger. This is what actually initiates the arc to flash over. And what we have is basically two high voltages, which I've called high voltage generator, approximately 300 volts that charges the cap, and that's connected directly across the terminals of the Xenon flash tube. And then we have very high voltage generator in a range between 1 and 4 kilovolts, sometimes more, sometimes less. It depends on the flash tube. Usually 1 to 2 kilovolts is enough to initiate the arc in this. This is basically like an ignition coil. That's exactly what it does. It just initiates very high voltage. But instead of a spark, this actually ionizes the very little amount of xenon gas inside the tube, which allows the current to pass through and the arc to form. And this is being triggered. Both units are supplied from some sort of power supply, whatever that might be. In a camera, the power supply obviously comes from a DC to DC converter on the board, and the flash circuit needs some time to recharge. And usually that's 5 to 10 seconds or so before the capacitor gets fully charged and it's able to produce another discharge inside the xenon tube. Now, another application of a circuit like this would be to make a stroboscopes like you've got in the nightclubs and so on. But the difference is those stroboscopes charge up those capacitors really quickly, so they're much higher power supplies and high voltage generators. Very often, and they use just rectified mains to charge up capacitor, so there is abundant amount of power coming into it, so the capacitor is able to recharge up to 3, 4, 5, 10 times per second to produce the continuous flashing. My plan today is to pull the components out of it, and I will be making just a simple flash circuit that will be able to flash at some frequency. It all depends on this transformer, how much power we can pump through this to charge up the capacitor. Now, I don't particularly fancy putting this across the mains. It would work, but the flash tube in here is far too small for this. If we flash it too quickly, too many times per second for any extended period of time, it will fail. So first let's pull all the components out, and then we're gonna have to pull this is the switching component here, and it's a IGBT, insulated gate bipolar transistor. So let's pull out the wires for the xenon flash tube, and then here this is connected directly to the ignition coil, and let's pull the flash capacitor. 330 volts, Rubicon photo flash, good flash capacitor. This will give you a really nice jolt if you don't discharge them, so be careful. I have discharged this prior. But now we've got a bunch of surface mount components and multi-leg components like the transformers. So yeah, I don't fancy the soldering it this using soldering iron, because it will be relatively uneasy. Ideal thing for this would be a hot air station, which I haven't got. What I have is a heat gun, high power. It's actually a 2 kilowatt heat gun, but it has electronic temperature control and fan control. And here it is. As you can see, it's a large item. It's comfortably being held like this, and it's got a wide nozzle. Nicely heats up a large amount of area, which is helpful sometimes. And it has both fan control on the back and the temperature control. If you use just a regular heat gun, you will toast the board to ashes. Pair of tweezers, and let's get this started. So we want to go to 320 degrees, and we can start heating up the board. It is good to heat up a larger board area. It just makes it easy, and then when you want to take one component out, you focus on that smaller part, and that will quickly liquefy all the solder. Okay, there we go, that's the IGBT. Okay, the transformer, the ignition coil. So there we go, it works. Not only as a hot air station, but also a barbecue starter and paint stripper. Really handy. So let's look at the transformer. It's a six-pin device. There are six legs on the transformer. And one of the middle legs, in fact, the transformer was on the board this way. This middle here on this side goes directly to one of the pins on the flash capacitor. So this would be one part of the high voltage. On the other side, the middle pin goes to, or used to go, went to this diode. And this diode goes to this track, and that again goes to the other side of the flash capacitor. So here we have how it would be so far. What else? Here is the ignition coil. And here is IGBT. So this is how I think it's going to lay out. We have to make an oscillator for this. That should be a short task for a 555 timer circuit. But first, let's buzz out the rest of the connections. So we know the two middle ones. This will be our, let's call it 300 volts output. Those two and those two, both sides are connected. So I want to figure out what's happening there. What we have is a very similar transformer to the one that was on this little thing. So we've got two primary coils on a single core and high voltage output. This really asks for a Joule circuit to be built around this, because yeah, we've got two primary coils, which we can use this and this transistor. I hope it's a transistor NPN. I've just tested it with a component tester, didn't bother looking up datasheet. It's an emitter collector base layout, or base collector emitter, whichever way you want to start counting from. And yeah, it's an NPN transistor. So this will do very well with that transformer to form an oscillator circuit. The circuitry on here looks a little bit more complex than just a simple Joule teeth, but for our application, I think that will do just fine. IGBT is in the path between the capacitor and the flash tube, so this is where the flash tube was connected to. Basically, what they were using this for, control the length of the pulses, so the flash wouldn't use up all their energy in the capacitor. It would just use up a small amount in order to produce a couple of flashes. Some cameras do that. After thinking a little bit for what is happening over here, the IGBT, the function of the IGBT that we've pulled out that was sitting over here was confusing me a little bit. But I think I've got it worked out. I've drawn a little schematic of what I think is happening here. I've traced out all the tracks, and yeah, I think that's what it is. So this is the output here, the output of the transformer, the high voltage. And it goes through a diode and it charges a capacitor, the big flash capacitor. Then the positive of the flash capacitor goes to the xenon tube. Then the tube goes here to a 100k resistor down to negative. The positive goes through a 1 meg resistor to this capacitor and a diode. Then the IGBT, this will be the trigger input, the gate of the IGBT. And there is another capacitor and the primary of the ignition transformer, and going to the negative. And of course the output of the ignition transformer goes to the outer casing of the xenon flash tube. And the way I suspect the circuit works is the capacitor gets charged through a diode. Now the current cannot go much else through the tube, because the tube is not conductive until the high voltage pulse. One more thing happens here. Through this 1 meg resistor and through here and through the cap, the primary coil, slowly this cap gets charged up, and it also holds a small little charge. Now then what happens over here at this point, a small impulse comes in. This impulse, whenever this impulse happens, this will switch on this IGBT. IGBT more effectively becomes a short. This automatically connects the flash tube in parallel with the capacitor through this diode. Current flow would be through here, through here, through here, and like so. But it's not conducting just yet, because it needs an impulse. But what also happens, this charged up capacitor that initially had some charge over here, through the coil of the primary ignition transformer, this gets shorted out as well, so this effectively produces a sharp spike of current in this direction, and that produces the impulse necessary to energize the flash tube. So it is interesting that they're using the actual 300 volts or so from this point in order to charge up this cap. It's interesting that they've used the IGBT over here, and I wondered why, and I think I know. So sometimes cameras are able to produce a few very closely spaced flashes from the flash for some red eye reduction effect and some other purposes, focusing, whatever else, but they'll do a few blinks and then they'll do main flash. So what's happening here on the gate of the IGBT? For example, if you had three flashes and then the main one, it would the gate voltage would go somewhat like this, and that will produce just three short flashes, and then a moment later it will produce a longer one. This works because the moment this IGBT disconnects, it breaks the circuit and the flash tube will stop conducting, because if the circuit is broken, there's no current flow through the discharge arc. So the only thing left over here for me to do is to pull out this cap, this diode, and this cap here, because I'm determined to reuse parts from this board, and put together a little PCB that will allow me to hold this together. Here I replaced the transformer from the insect terminator with the transformer I pulled out from the camera, and let's see if that will work. So I got it hooked up to a 3 volt power supply. If I press the button, yeah, the current is dropping. You could see the current decreasing as it was charging up the cap, so I'm quite sure the cap is now charged. Yes, it is. So now I've replicated the circuit with the transistor that was inside the camera that I've desoldered, and I've just added a few copper legs just to make it easier to solder up, and let's see, will it oscillate? Here is the negative, and the positive should go to collector, which is the middle pin on the transistor. Okay, we've got current about half an amp, a little bit more. The question is, has it charged the capacitor? Ah, yes it did. So let's see what sort of voltage we are getting to. Current is a little bit high, half an amp. This must be getting moderately warm. It starts with about an amp and then it drops to about 0.5, and then it goes back up again. I think I won't be able to use this in continuous mode. I've got a 680 ohm resistor going to the base of the transistor. I'm going to increase this resistance a little bit, maybe 1.5k, double that roughly, and see what will happen. Okay, test number two. And again, I'm feeding just 3 volts into this, as you can see. And let's see what will happen now. Okay, the current is significantly lower, but then it goes back up to half an amp. So the current initially drops. Yeah, the transistor's getting really warm. What I think is happening over here, that's why the current increases initially. Initially it starts high and oscillates and gets to a state where the capacitor is charged. Then the oscillations get attenuated and the transistor essentially slowly goes into a saturation mode and just starts conductive. That's why it gets hot, and that's why it draws a lot of current. So one way to stop that from happening, I think, it's just a guess, but put a capacitor between the base and the transformer, or between the power and the transformer of the other coil. Let's try that and see what will happen. Just 100 nanofarad capacitor. It's right here in between the positive coming in, the coil, the resistor, and the base of the transistor. This should limit DC going in here and switching on the transistor. This should only allow for oscillation. So let's see if that will stop the transistor getting saturated. Well, nothing is happening. Okay, that didn't work. Oops, slight problem. I've toasted the transistor. And there we go. It released the smoke. Oopsies. Well, okay, we're gonna have to use a different one. Playing a little bit with this transformer, I was wondering why was it not charging the capacitor, and I was being not careful enough, and one of the high voltage pins, or maybe both of them, I ripped the really thin wire off, and oops, that's not going to work now. I remembered I got this. So that's another circuit, and we've got the high voltage transformer here and a lot bigger xenon flash tube, so we'll use that instead. Let's first see how this circuit works here, how it maybe there is a simple oscillator. I've got a beefier transistor here to salvage, so maybe we'll use that. And here is this circuit, I've worked it out, I've removed majority of the components to make it clearer. And what we're left with is two transistors here, one transistor here, two electrolytic caps, one resistor, one ceramic cap, one high voltage cap, diode and the transformer. And this forms an oscillator like this. And this is the transformer. I'm not sure exactly of the coil arrangement in there, but when in circuit I measured it out, it turns out that those pins, so pin 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5, have got 216 ohms, so that would be the high voltage coil. Then in series there appears to be a smaller coil, 0.3 of an ohm and then 0.1 of an ohm between one and pins 1 and 2. And it's connected like so. We've got the 100 picofarad. This is a high voltage cap, 4.7k resistor, filter cap 330 micro. This is the bigger transistor here, 22 nano cap, and the Darlington array made up of those two transistors, JC327. So there's just generic PNP transistors connected in a Darlington configuration, and the electrolytic cap. This oscillates. So now I can use that circuit to generate high voltage to input here. And here is the full schematic of both the high voltage generation circuit and the trigger circuit. I'm doing the toner transfer right now, so I'm going to etch this board in a moment. I will build it entirely out of salvaged components from just random junk. First I need to put it through a number of times through this, peel it off and etch it. And by the way, before I was using this high gloss photo paper, and I've still got quite a bit left, but I bought recently this. This is also from Poundland and slightly different premium glossy photo paper. Well, the packaging is different. I'm wondering whether it will be just as good. The other one was brilliant actually. So there is some fine tracks over there. Here is what the PCB should look like. Is the paper just as good as the other one? And I think it is. This is a perfect transfer. It leaves this white coating on there, but that's just the top layer from the paper. If I angle it right, you'll be able to see the ghost image a little bit. And that just helps with masking off. That's the board. The repeatability and precision of this method by toner transfer from my brother printer is amazing. On this board I'm going to give it a coat of tin using my currentless tin plating solution. And because I'm feeling adventurous today, I will be putting on silkscreen just to see how it turns out. And I messed it up a little bit. It turned out there is something on there, but I didn't get a full transfer. I was peeling off the paper and I moved it, and yeah. I've discovered that to get rid of the hazy coating on the toner, to get a nice black toner without actually removing the toner itself, a really good thing to use is just rubbing alcohol. I've got a little bit here, but if I... You see, it gets all the haziness off and the toner stays. And even on the copper side, if I just need to be more cautious with regards to placement of the descriptions. I'm wondering if it's gonna get killed in soldering process because the toner might melt. I'm going to start with the surface mount stuff.
Tap one of the legs.
Okay, I was able to tackle four of them. Excellent, so now the other side. And that's my surface mount parts done, now the through holes. It will be an absolute joke if this thing doesn't work after I've put this together. But as with many things in life, the joy is in the making, right? And here it is, completed. But there is one problem. It doesn't bloody work. And I figured out why it doesn't work. The problem is me. So it has crossed my mind already whether not to scrap this video completely and throw this in the bin and forget about it. But I do not give up that easily. This thing would haunt me for the rest of my days. When you're dealing with 500 volts or so, do not make 0.2 mm track spacing and flat fill everything with ground just because you can. I have switched it on and the oscillator works. But the trigger with IGBT didn't work for some odd reason. Yeah, at that point I thought, let me discharge the cap before I handle this. So when I discharged the cap, it immediately vaporized some of the tracks. This video is turning into a little bit of a nightmare because it's like the fourth day that I'm trying to shoot this. And I've got half an hour here, 1 hour there, and yeah, I was rushing with the PCB and that's where I got the delay. Time for a new PCB, transplant everything from here to the new one. But this time I'm going to make the oscillator and high voltage generator with a flash on one board. And then I'm going to try out this IGBT circuit on a separate board. If it works, awesome. If it doesn't, I'll make a different circuit to make it to go flash, flash, flash. And because I'm on a roll with etching PCBs, and I know the photo paper works quite well, I'm tempted to try this out. Toolstation has sent me this catalog, which I've already ripped two pages out for the current PCB. Yeah, they must have watched my video and they thought, hey, please try one of our paper, one of our catalogs, because the paper is so thin and so shiny. It might actually work really well for etching. And here is my new design printed on the said paper. And I'll spare you watching me feed this to the laminator. I'm just going to get on with this and show you the result. Right, check this out. And it's transferred with the image from the magazine. Yeah, that's a little bit unusual. But that image does come off with a little bit of rubbing. What I suspected is just the top layer, and that will easily come off with a little bit of rubbing alcohol. Okay, it did transfer nice. It's just additional step that needs to be done to get this image off. But the toner sits really, really nicely on there. There we go. That's rather perfect. So, etching again. And the board is ready, all drilled, and with the silk screen. And as you can see, it turned out quite okay, this one. Tracks are much thicker. Interestingly, on this side, when I transferred the silkscreen, I didn't spray the paper with water and put it through laminator. I just did it all dry. And what that resulted in, no ghost transfer of the picture from the magazine. This catalog paper works quite well. And I've got over 200 pages of that. And sometime later, I've got all the parts transplanted yet again. This is turning out to be quite a Frankenstein of a project. Let's just test it so I can connect the negative here. I've got 3.3 volt over here, and if I connect this, yeah, I can hear it. Okay, 290 volts. Time to transplant this yet again to another circuit board, so I'll quickly make a PCB for this. If this circuit doesn't work using the IGBT, I will make another different circuit to make this flash. And here is the circuit. After some iterations and some changes and numerous transplants of parts between boards, but yeah, let's make sure it works. I have 3.4, so about 3.5 volts. I can apply the power here. We know this board works and you can hear the squeal. Now if I touch those two points here, the wire and the little copper loop, there we go. It flashes. So let's have a look at the circuit. First, let's fully discharge the cap. Now there is a few changes to it, and here is the schematic, at least the first iteration of what I did. So I altered the schematic a little bit. So before there was a diode and another capacitor, and yeah, it was, I thought it was unnecessary after a while. And besides, I didn't want to go back to the surface mount parts because of the voltage creeping across the tracks, and you can only get the track so far apart when you're using a little 0805 parts. I got it down to one resistor, second resistor, one cap, the ignition transformer, and the IGBT. with one exception. The IGBT, when I put the circuit together, the IGBT worked about 10 times. There is clearly something I didn't know about IGBTs in general, and I fried it one way or another, not sure why. The way the circuit works, this is connected to the positive of the flash cap and to the ground, and through this 1 meg resistor, this capacitor here, which is this red one here, it's a 400 volt cap, just what I had in the junk bin, and this charges up to decent amount of voltage, somewhat slowly, but it's just a 100 nano cap, so it doesn't need much energy. Then when this transistor gets switched on, the charge that's accumulated in the cap discharges through the primary of the ignition transformer and goes to the ground, which creates a spike that goes to the, if I draw a flash tube over here, and this will go into side of the flash tube. High voltage spike ionizes the xenon gas inside and produces a spark. When I've put the little IGBT, which I've got here, it did work. I promise you, it did work about 10 times or so. Gave up its life. It's now a dead short, so it's no good anymore. I have replaced the IGBT with an SCR. Part number SCR2149, from what I can see. But a brief look at datasheet, I wasn't able to find anything, but I was able to figure out where is the anode, cathode and the gate from the board where I pulled it out from. And that works well. Something like this. And yeah. There you go, one more time, because it's not so visible. So the SCR actually requires quite a bit of a voltage on the gate to switch it on. So what I'm doing, I've pulled a wire, this wire here. I've pulled it from this point, which is connected to this capacitor. And basically, I've got those two wires sticking out. And if I touch those two together, SCR pulls the current through the capacitor, and that's enough to energize the xenon flash. So I did promise I'm gonna make it flash one way or another. See, I'm slightly disappointed that I killed the little IGBT. I was keen to experiment a little bit further with that, with maybe the width of the pulse I'm able to provide to it, but nonetheless, maybe I'll find another one somewhere else. For this video, that's it. Thank you very much for watching. I think I've spent already far too much time doing this. It was a bit of a project constipation, this. I consider that a success, one way or another. I hope you enjoyed this Frankenstein journey with me. And yeah, thank you for watching. Please do subscribe for more random electronics related stuff. And for the time being, take care.